How are you doing? Morning, everybody. Right.
Kena mena nama ni. Kalau kuma kau palti mena, kalau kana nuranga gugda aran da mena kuma. Maru wechanga kalau kubuk yana porkana kuma kana mena yalara kalau wanga ni manin pun ni kani yata na palti ara. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome here today. We're kuma kau dance group. Kuma kau means one blood in Ngana language, the local Aboriginal language. We'd like to welcome you all here. And we represent many different Aboriginal groups from around South Australia, the Gugutha, the Aranda, the Kukana, the Narunga, the Ngarangeti, the Ngadri, and so on. That's why our name is Kumakaru. We represent the diversity of Aboriginal people in South Australia. And we're more than honoured to be able to welcome you here into our language, and it's a great honour for us to be able to have Uncle Bakti, Uncle Richard here to come and join us down here in Kaurna country. So. Before we go into our welcome to country, we're going to sing you a song, which is a welcoming song. which talks to the spirits. The song we just sang is a cleansing song, and this dance is just calling upon spirits to come and join us today, and then followed by our Welcome to Country dance we call Manitaula, the Good Spirit Dance.
How do I follow that? And every time I come up on stage after following that, I said to myself, how do I follow that? Right. What I will do, of course, is add my respects and my personal and deep felt respects to the traditional owners, the original peoples of the land, past, present, and the future, the Kaurna people and the elders who are here with us today. Hello, aunties. How is everybody today? Thank you for being with us to share in a very special occasion here in the University of South Australia. For those who don't know me, and for those who are trying to look for the subtitles as I speak at this speed, I'm David Lloyd. I'm the still newish Vice-Chancellor of and President of this university. And I had my own personal welcome to country from the community, from the traditional owners, back in March. And it was a completely moving experience. Kumakara, who are a fantastic group, performed that day as well. And it was an absolutely stirring experience for me to be welcome to country. So I'm glad, Richard, you've been able to share in a welcome to country in a traditional fashion here in Adelaide today. Now, ordinarily, a Vice-Chancellor is handed a really big, long speech to read. And I would stand here and go through it page by page, and you'd have to suffer through it. However, I do realise that people are not here to listen to me today, and that you haven't come to hear me talk about how for 22 years participation and mentoring and engagement with culture has been at the heart of our institution. What you're here today is to realise that our institution has a commitment to develop reconciliation, to engage with communities, to go beyond reconciliation, and to involve all elements of our community in education, in pathways and participation. And we're delighted that we were able to announce the partnership that we have with AIME, and Jack is going to talk about AIME in the course of the morning. And I figured what we try and do is maximise our discussion time. So the speech goes to one side. I'm going to be very, very brief. I'll say two things. You're going to get a little bit of Jack's story in the course of this morning. But really, I wanted to make a point that we are delighted to be hosting the event and to be able to learn more about AIME and how it actually works to change the lives of Indigenous students as they make that pathway through life, through participation in mentoring. We had a great conversation last night over dinner about what mentoring means to individuals and how it can have a major difference on your pathway as you know, as you're trying to find your way. For me, as a Vice Chancellor, to have our students engaged as mentors, it just speaks to what goes on beyond the classroom and the extracurricular component of education and how important that is to have well-rounded people giving back to society in this way. So it helps our students, it helps the schools, it helps teachers, and it helps connect directly with Indigenous Australians to break down the cultural divides that do exist still today in 21st century Australia. This for us is a leap forward in terms of our commitment to reconciliation, and I believe it has the ability to make a profound difference to both the Indigenous and non-Indigenous participants in the scheme. I do have to single out one person for embarrassment, Trina Clark. There she is, Matt. We were going to get Trina to come up and talk, but she said that she wouldn't be able to walk across the stage without falling over. She's the program manager here at UniSA. She's a graduate, she's an esteemed alumnus, and she has an honours degree in public relations, and she was the South Australian NAIDOC Scholar of the Year in 2012, and now she's the lead on the AIME program here in UniSA. So those in the room, you will get to know Trina over time, and Trina, we're really pleased to have you here in this role today. She's an absolute ambassador for UniSA. It says in my notes, Jack, that you founded AIME at the remarkable age of 19. Right? So I'm not quite sure if you want to comment on age. And we did talk about 40 years. A man who's been 40 years in business and how long we've been in business and what we might learn from an older individual. But we had a lot of jibes last night about youth. Youth is no impediment to ambition. And there's no impediment to the realization of ambition. I think, you know, if you get up and you feel like you can do it, you should go ahead and try to do it. That's one of the big messages that needs to come out of today. So after Jack talks a little bit about his story, then it'll be an honor, and it is an honor, to welcome our special international guest to the Uni today. He's an avid Star Trek fan, and the real difference between Richard and other Star Trek fans is that he's building his own Starship Enterprise. But for more than four decades, Sir Richard Branson has been a household name. He's an entrepreneur, a pioneer, an activist, an adventurer, a humanitarian, and a mentor. And his partnership with AIME is something that we want to understand greater today, and we're very, very grateful to be able to have some of your time with us here today, Richard. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Jack. Jack's going to take over as MC, and we're going to engage in a little bit of participation with you as an audience. So thank you for enduring, and welcome to UniSA.
Hey guys, I'm going to jump down here. What's happening? You good? Everyone really good? Everyone feeling good today? Really happy, really excited about being here at AIME. We're first starting in South Australia. That's pretty cool, hey? What? My name's Jack Manning Bancroft. I'm going to tell you a very quick story, because I like stories, because my mum used to tell me stories when I was a little kid, and then she used to make up all these stories, like these amazing stories about these animals going through the bush and then heading down to these like mystical planets and then jumping on planes and then going out into space. And actually, come to think about it, stories sound a little bit like what Rich has actually done in his life. So those journeys, those moments that Mum sort of painted in my mind as a kid were always about dreaming what was possible. And I was lucky enough to have an incredibly strong role model as a mother who's an Aboriginal artist named Bronwyn Bancroft. So my family's Aboriginal through my mum's side, not Aboriginal from my dad's side, so I suppose I can kind of walk a little bit between both worlds. And I remember waking up like in the morning at about 3 o'clock in the morning when we were kids, and you'd see Mum outside painting and painting and painting away. And I think I learnt through my mother that whether you're Aboriginal or not, if you want to be successful in life, it takes a lot of hard work. And it takes hard work and hard work and hard work, and the more you can do that, the more chance you have to achieve what you want to be. And so I went through school. I was, you know, when I was 14 or 15, like you guys, all I wanted to do was play cricket for Australia. So I'm still hanging on to that at the moment. I think the Australian cricket team needs me. All I really wanted to do was play sport. And I got through school, got dropped from the first grade footy team when I was 17. And then I went, okay, well, maybe I should do some of this study stuff. And I went and hung around with a couple of mates who were a lot smarter than me, who sort of pulled me up and got me through that end of year sort of certificate, which is a HSC in New South Wales. burgled my way into uni and actually got a scholarship to go to uni. So they had this big leadership scholarship, which I think there were a bunch of sort of rich bankers that were sitting at this game of footy in Sydney watching the Wallabies play. And there's a guy called Andrew Walker, I'm not sure if you guys remember him. He was a mad Aboriginal like footballer who played for the Wallabies. And I'm pretty sure these guys were like, oh, I'd be mad if we could get Andrew Walker to come to Sydney Uni and play footy for us. Anyway, they got me. So I went into this scholarship interview, and for any of the students in the room, whether you're uni students or high school students, my first lesson to you would be fake it till you make it. So in the interview, we sat there, and it was kind of like a bit like UniSA, a little bit older. I don't know if you guys have seen Harry Potter. You know those big, tall buildings everywhere, and you've got everyone in their cloaks, and you feel like wizards are about to zap you and turn you into a frog. That's what it felt like walking up this tower into this first interview. And these guys said to me, Jack, you know, why should we give this a scholarship to you and not to anybody else? And so 17, I went, well, think quick. Not sure why you should give it to me, but my only answer would be if I'm going to get this scholarship, I'm going to want to put something back. And if I do something in my life or I commit to do something, I'm going to try and make it as big as it possibly can be. So I got the scholarship, and then I went into uni. I'm like, shit, better create something big. So for the first couple of years, I was sort of testing, how do we get Australians, all Australians, to see Indigenous Australia as part of our national identity, to see it as an important thing that we can all be proud of as a country? Because I think, you know, you hear about us overseas, it's like, oh, Australia, yeah, you guys are mad, like boxing kangaroos and 200 years of history, and you're kind of like, no, we've got 60,000, like, we've got a bit more richness than most places in the entire planet. In fact, we've got the oldest continuous surviving culture in the whole world. So there's that piece, and the other piece was, to be honest, I just got the shits with the complaining about the problems facing Indigenous Australia. I got frustrated with the only role models we saw in newspapers were AFL players, rugby league players, and then you heard stories about drunks and alcoholics. And I got frustrated because I saw kids like you guys, and I went, I know how much talent you have, I know how much ability you have, and I know it's just a matter of lighting the fuse, because the reality is, at the moment, there's 200 Indigenous doctors out there in Australia, and there's another 200 in training. There's an Indigenous pilot working for Virgin who's travelling around Australia at the moment and flying planes for them. There's some amazingly talented, gifted Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people out there making a huge difference to Australian life, and that comes down to the attitude of what you guys want to set out. So we went down, fast-forwarding now. I was 19, I was kind of like, oh, well, what we'll do is we'll get a bunch of uni students, we'll get my mates, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, and we'll go down and start working at a local high school in a place called Redfern, you guys might have heard of. And so we walked into this high school. Who's in year 9 here? Anyone in year 9? Yeah, good, okay. So you guys will get this. So we walked in and started working with a bunch of year 9 kids. And I don't know if anyone remembers being 14 or 15, but when you're in year 9, it's just your right to have attitude, let alone if you're in Redfern and you think you're a gangster. So all these kids are sitting there, hoodies on, going, yeah, what do you guys got? And we sort of came cruising in, and all the mentors were kind of like walking behind me. It was really odd. I was kind of like, what are you doing? Like, single file. And at that moment, kind of felt a little bit like, I don't know if anyone remembers being 11 or 12 years old, like being at a school dance. And you're there, you're in year 5 and year 6, the boys are on one side, the girls on the other side, and then the teacher puts on that like awkward music and then goes, all right guys, time to dance. And everyone's like, who goes first? That's what it was a little bit like there. And it was like being on that dance floor, and I think the most important thing was someone making that step. So we sort of got the mentors and the mentees together, and I remember this moment crystal clear, was you had these uni students there for the right reasons, not because they wanted to go and help Aboriginal people because they felt sorry for them. They wanted to go and learn from people like you guys. They wanted to learn how to be better people. And then the students who were there who actually wanted to step up. So we cut the bullshit. We weren't going to pander to the students, and we weren't going to pander to you guys. If you guys wanted to step up and have a good life, we'd walk every step of the way with you. But if you didn't, we'd go and work with kids that wanted to. So that snapshot of 25 kids and 25 uni students 8 or 9 years ago now has now grown to being, this year, between 2,000 to 3,000 Indigenous kids across Australia, over 1,500 uni students. I've got 100 full-time staff. Got given like awards for like Young Australian of the Year and all this sort of stuff, but none of that's important, because the thing that's important is that we have the potential to do something groundbreaking as a group for the whole country. And the challenge that I put to you guys now, as you start this program, as you start this as a group in South Australia, is I think AIME is a picture and a vision of what we can be when we're at our best, because it challenges us all to reach for what's inside of us and ask ourselves if we can be better. To reach for that potential inside and ask yourself, how much can you push yourself? And to put your hand out, if you're a uni student, and bring somebody with you along that journey that may not have had that opportunity that you have before. And for you guys, I promise you, you're going to have an amazing experience in the program, and we're really excited about working with you. And I think the situation where we stand today is I'm kind of going, well, why don't we take on the world now? Why don't we go and try and see if we can get this program around the world? Why don't we try and reach to have societies all around the planet where uni students put their hand back and bring high school kids with them and change the course of history in the process? Because I think the one thing we shy away from as Australians is the ability to reach for greatness. And we're about to talk to somebody who's done that their whole life, but there's nothing that stops us from being the game changers in the whole planet except for ourselves. It's those moments where you go back and you look in the mirror and you push yourself for how big you want to be and how much of an impact you want to make in your life. So today we're going to be launching our Mentors for Life program around Australia, which is sharing our mentoring model with individuals, the general public and businesses around the world, and that's going to help us fund the program back here in Australia with the kids as well. So, you know, 9 years on, we're now standing there, 100 staff, and now we're going to try and see if we can grow this thing around the world and have some fun in the process. So it's exciting, and the thing that inspires me is you guys stepping up to the table, you guys stepping up to be better and enjoying the opportunity and experience that you have in your time on this planet. So I think Yeah, it's cool to be here. It's cool to see the hoodies already and see the mentors here, and we'll jump back up and have a bit of a chat to Sir Richard Branson about his story. So thanks, guys, for having me here today. First question to open up, and we'll open up to a couple of questions a little bit later on, is can you paint a picture for me, Richard, of what the world looked like for you as a 14 or 15-year-old when you're in the situation where these students are at? What's life looking like for you, and where, what are you seeing on the horizon?
Well, I was 14 years old, 15 years old. I was not good at school, wanted to do something with my life. There was a very unnecessary war going on, the Vietnamese War. That was killing and maiming thousands of people, and a lot of young people of my age were thinking, you know, we've got to come up with a way of trying to stop this war, and I thought maybe we could start a school magazine that would campaign against the war, and give young people a way of expressing themselves, and so. You know, I started pulling together this school magazine and used the school phone box to sell a bit of advertising. And then when the magazine came out, young people liked it, and I decided to actually leave school to run it. And it became my education. So I learned a lot about about the world by going out and interviewing people and questioning people and young people then had a voice where they could express themselves through the magazine, so because I wasn't that good at school, I got my education from creating the magazine.
Do you remember after in that whirlwind of 15-year-old going out, big wide world, and going and interviewing lots of people, trying to tackle on massive issues like wars around the world. Do you remember the first person you looked at as a mentor, or the first person that sort of took an interest in you? You said you weren't particularly good at school, but someone outside that said, "Hey, hang on a minute, this guy might have something special."
Look, I think because I was because I believed in myself and believed in what I was doing and was enthusiastic. There were, a number of people who were willing to help. So there would be, say, a retired accountant who would, help me, work out my figures in the evenings. There were journalists from newspapers who would, who would sort of take me under their wings and help me. So I think if you do have an idea that enough determination, I think people will be willing to help you. And I think one set of mentors that I think don't get tapped into enough are people who've just retired. I mean, you know, when you retire, you know, life can be quite lonely, and so to be able to help, help take under your wing students or young people who are trying to create businesses is a great thing for elders to do when they step down from running businesses or working in accountancy firms or lawyer firms and so on. So I think with people here, if they've got if they're enthusiastic about something, I think they will be able to get people to help them. But you've got to have that enthusiasm first of all, so that people have got something to help you about.
And when you look at those, that accountant that helped you after hours, was it? Can you unpack for me how you got them to help you?
Well, I think they believed in what I was trying to do. What the kids here have to think about if they want to become, if they want to create a business, they have to think, how can I make a difference to other people's lives? What are other people not doing well that I could do better? And that's all that a business is. It's coming up with an idea that can improve other people's lives. If you come up with that idea and people like your idea, then I think a lot of people will want to help you. So I think what would be a great exercise for the students here to do is try to think, who's not doing something very well. If you've got a hobby, is there a better way of doing it? And if there's a better way of doing it, you have a business. And then if you've created something which is improving other people's lives, then you'll find mentors who'll be very happy to come and help you, I think.
And if you fast forward to today for us, a long way from a 15-year-old starting a student magazine, who do you turn to for help now? Who are your mentors that you have today?
I think what I've learned is to find good people and delegate the day-to-day running of all our businesses to good people and giving them a lot of trust to make mistakes as well as to make good things, and not to criticize them if they make mistakes, because if you're going to try to create a business, you're going to make mistakes on the way, and in fact, if you're afraid of making mistakes, you won't create anything. So you've got to find people who are willing to just say screw it, let's do it, and try things. Sometimes fall flat on their face, sometimes pick themselves up, So my mentors are just a mass of people around the world who work for Virgin who are coming up with new ideas all the time, and then a lot of people are not working for Virgin. I mean, we have a Twitter account, and a lot of people communicate with us through the Twitter account or come up with business ideas through the Twitter account, and we have a team of people who sift through those and try to see if any stand out from the crowd, and a lot of our best businesses come from like people sitting in this room who come up with an idea for a business idea, who think that maybe Virgin could work with them on it, who approach us on it. And I think if you have a really good idea and you get turned down, don't give up. I mean, because trying to get an idea accepted is you're going to get kicked back time and time again. Just be absolutely determined to push your idea through, and hopefully ultimately you'll get it off the ground.
Yeah, awesome. We might open up for, I think we've got time for about 5 questions from the group. So anyone that wants to be brave and chuck their hand up and ask a question. There's someone up the back.
Has to be right at the very back.
Hello. Hi. Hi, Richard. How are you?
Very good.
That's good. The question was asked whether, who are your mentors? Do you actually mentor a lot of other people, or are you open to mentoring people yourself?
I go out on the road. I feel like a bit like a rock star on tour sometimes. So do talks and answer questions and so share some of my experiences in that way. And I put aside about 30 days a year to do that. Do it in universities like this, this afternoon I'm doing a speech and raising money for our foundation as well, and hopefully in these discussions a few ideas seep through to people. And there was one talk I was doing once in Greece, and this person kept on asking me questions, and I kept on answering them. They ended up coming to England and competing with our company, so I sort of slightly regretted that particular discussion. So it's really through situations like this, through writing books. I've written about 6 or 7 books, and that's the kind of way I share what I've learned.
Thank you very much. You're very inspirational.
Thank you.
And so I was also wondering what you do, if anything, to support women and girls to achieve in business.
At the National...
The National Achievers Congress that you're running, it doesn't have any female speakers, so there's about 15 men speaking about how they're achieving things.
I don't think we're running something called the National Achievers Congress. I think I might be speaking at it.
I think that might be the question about. So is there another way to work that question? Is what's your how do you look at women in business, and I suppose the growth and change you've seen over the last 20 years, and what excites you about women entrepreneurship and what you're seeing coming through?
Yeah, I think it's a good point. If there is a conference and it doesn't have women speakers, they're making a mistake. They need to get a balance. I was talking earlier about companies and how little representation there is in boardrooms of women, and I think a lot of our Virgin companies are not by no means perfect, but I think there is something to be said that there should be a law that actually says that 50% of all companies should have 50% of women representative, because unless you force an issue like that, companies themselves, because they're run by men, are apt to just think, well, we'll take on more men in the boardroom. I think companies themselves will benefit, but from having more equal representation of women and men. It's difficult to change people's, it's difficult to sort of shift people, and sometimes you need legal ways to actually try to shift people.
Can I just add, do you think
Yeah, is that the place I'm talking this afternoon? I'm sorry, I'm just trying to think which place it is.
We might. Why don't we hold it?
I will definitely. If it's the place I'm talking this afternoon, I'll definitely have a word with them.
What else have we got? Probably space for about 3 more questions. Who wants to throw a real curveball? What else you got?
You should come along this afternoon and give them help.
Why did you decide to help the AIME program?
I would like to take credit for it, but it was the team at Virgin Australia that got involved, and it seems, from the little I know about it, it just seems like a great idea. I think we all benefit from mentors, and And I think this is a tremendous program, and I'm very, very, very pleased that they're helping. But anyway, I had no involvement myself at all. But I'm very delighted they've done that.
We're happy too. Two more questions. We might go one right at the back to really test you, and then we'll have one in the front section.
I'm just trying to remember exactly where it was, but I went up for a week into the Aboriginal community up north, and anyway, had a wonderful week there. All that, but I do remember there was an awful lot of flies. So I don't know if any of you remember.
Up the back. We got one.
Hi Richard, first I'd like to say thanks so much for acknowledging the importance of our people. Second, I'd like to ask, when you have a dream or a goal and you get to that point where it's just not working as easy as you'd like it to, or there's just so many barriers, what advice do you have to people who probably are at the lowest point and just need to keep pushing forward for their goal?
Well, I think the people who are going to achieve their dreams and their goals are the people who take the knocks, get knocked down, pick themselves up, try again, get knocked down, pick themselves up, try again, learn from every knock, and then ultimately they'll break through. And it can take a long time to finally be successful. Somebody earlier, I think it was yourself, just said, look, you've got to work pretty hard in life to achieve your dreams. And it's true. You'd be extraordinarily lucky if you're successful the first time round. So just don't give up. If you fail the first time, try again. If you fail the second time, try again. Keep picking yourself up until you're successful. And ultimately, I'm sure you will be successful if you dream hard enough. Well, good luck.
Awesome. How about last question? Have we got the mic somewhere else? There we go.
Hello. What do you think has been the biggest barrier in your life to achieving your goals, and how did you overcome it?
I think that for anybody starting off trying to create something, lack of financial resources is definitely a big issue. I didn't have any money when I started, and I had to try to conjure resources out of thin air by coming up with projects where I could sort of sell in advance the idea to people, get the money up front, and then launch the product. We came very, very close to failure on a number of occasions. There's a very thin dividing line between success and failure. We just managed to stay the right side of that dividing line. We were struggling to pay the bills. In the end, we did survive. Survival when you're building a business is the key word, and you've just got to do everything you can to try to survive and pay the bills. Are you going to start a business, or what are your plans?
I hope so one day. I'd really like to make a difference in the world. I have a lot of interest in working with international students. Fascinated
me, and I think it's really important to support
those people in our community that struggle to support themselves and give them the inspiration and the hope to achieve what they can.
Yeah, one way of fulfilling your dream is to build a business and then use the resources from that to get out and try to make a difference in the world. What we're trying to do is encourage all businesses to become forces for good, rather than business to be there to make money and then social workers and governments to be there to look after society. If we can actually get every single business in the world to adopt problems and get out there and try to fix problems, I think we'll get on top of most of the world's problems. So we're doing quite a big campaign to try to get business to become a force for good.
Awesome. That'll wrap us up for today. So from on behalf of everybody here, Rich, I want to say thank you for coming along. I think it's a very humbling thing, I think, for us as a group who are trying to do something really powerfully together, to have your support here and the university's support with the Vice-Chancellor has been fantastic. So join me in giving a round of applause for Sir Richard Branson.